sign, thank you, minutes.
20. Good afternoon, welcome to the session. The topic is capacity building, a very important topic. We know that we can have excellent methodologies, excellent resources, but without people to put in place all this with the correct skills, we have a problem every time. So we have four presentations. The first from Georgia, Dema Tsirvatsky. He's a PhD candidate, and he works for USDA in Tbilisi, Georgia. He's a team leader and agricultural advisor with expertise on agricultural statistics, agricultural economics, trade, and rural development. Mr. Dema managed technical capacity building programs between the United States and Georgia in the fields of agricultural statistics, agricultural policy and trade, animal and plant health, food safety, agricultural extension and education, scientific and agricultural exchange programs. Since 2008, he has organized over 30 capacity building and educational visits in the United States and more than 80 training sessions in the field of agricultural statistics in Georgia. Mr. Tsirvatsky is an active member of the advisory board of National Statistics Office in Georgia, Geostat. He will talk about capacity building in agricultural statistics, the case of Georgia. Mm-hmm. Please, you have the floor.
Good afternoon, and I hope that you are not tired after the listening and attending different sessions, and but I think that coffee is helping all of us, including myself, so we are fresh, and I'm happy to start sharing the experience, you know, just regarding the capacity building work and the activities in case of Georgia. As chair of a session, Dr. Flavio introduced, I represent the U.S. Department of Agriculture, but I'm permanently based in Tbilisi, Georgia. So I'm mostly, we do, our objective is to help Georgia to just advance and enhance the agricultural systems, including the agricultural statistics. So today's my presentation, I will focus on only our work and capacity building that we started many years ago, like since 2006, but we still continue. And I think that you will see how much progress actually Georgia made with assistance and with capacity building work. But before I go my presentation, I would like to give you some short overview about the country, you know, some small data, because we have people more than 100, you know, countries, and I think it will be interesting. You know, Georgia is a small country, you know, with 3.7 million people, but most of them are, you know, just engaged in rural activities, and they live in rural areas, and 99% of them, they are somehow engaged in agriculture. But though agriculture share in GDP is very small, so, I think 7.8%. And then speaking about Georgia, you know, just it's a small size, but its climate is very diverse. We have a different climate zones and then several micro climate zones, so which allows a small country on the area with 69,700 square kilometers to grow almost, you know, just we say that all crops that United States grows, you know, in huge almost continent, because we have a climate like a subtropical climate that we grow like a citrus, tea, all lemons, oranges, and feijoa, and we grow also berries, like grapes, you know, and but it's one side is good, but our agriculture is so diverse. But for the agriculture statistics, it's not easy work, you know. It's because when you're going with small holders, you know, small agricultural holders, and you're asking questionnaire, they have everything, you know. They have a cattle, they have poultry, they have corn, grains, fruits, vegetables. So which means that in small areas. So for agriculture statistics, so it's not easy work to make sure that your data is accurate, but we'll see how Georgia progressed and enhanced their systems. And because of that, and then total agricultural holdings, you know, it's like is 642,200, and then out of them, 2,200 are legal entities. So I wanted to give you short, you know, brief overview, because and then now agricultural statistics systems of Georgia. Georgia has a long history of data collection, because maybe some of them you know and knows that Georgia used to be a part of the Soviet Union for 70 years. So which means that Soviet Union was producing statistics, and then Georgia was part of it, but during everything was centralized, everything was planned, you know, and during the Soviet times, and statistics was not exception. So which means that, yes, Georgia has had a history of data collection, but not on sampling practices. Georgia has a centralized statistical system, so which means that it has an independent statistics agency. It's what we call like a Geostat, National Statistics Office of Georgia. And then all official statistics is just guided or by the law on official statistics, which regulates all statistical system and sets the principles of coordination between different government institutions. And the National Statistics Office of Georgia was formed as an independent agency in February 2010. So which means that before that, Geostat used to be under the Ministry of Economy and Sustainable Development. So which means that somehow, it was always a question mark about its independence, because when it is under the different ministries, so it's very hard. So finally, just Georgia has evolved and made National Statistics Service as an independent agency. And then Geostat is managed by a board of consisting of government representatives and private sector professional. And also Geostat has an external advisory board to analyze different statistical system methodologies and programs, and to also provide recommendations for the executive management. And I'm one of a member of the external advisory board of the National Statistics System. Now, let me move to some actual work what USDA does. We are part of a Foreign Agricultural Service, and we have our partner agency, we call National Agricultural Statistics Service of USDA. We started collaboration with Geostat in 2006. And this 2006 is a year. Then Georgia made the decision to change their data collection system, and they moved on a sample surveys methodology. Because USDA is working with Geostat, we work with also Ministry of Environmental Protection and Agriculture of Georgia, because they also have a need of data, and they have a statistical division that we are trying to collect more operative data for their planning activities. So, my presentation, I will go by years, you know, some different ranges, you know, starting from 2006 and until today. So you see that to the first agricultural census of independence, Georgia, like we got our second independence in 1991. So it was the first agricultural census was conducted in 2004. So, and actually when data was analyzed and produced, just somehow USDA and US government decided that, all right, it's a time to step in and provide some technical support and capacity building to Georgia's in order to, they made the political decision to change the statistical system. So we see that, there will be some high need on capacity building and training to a time that Georgia really faced. So it means that they had only few people who had been attending several training sessions in the EU or some other countries, but we were not really understanding, you know, how to change a methodology. So our experts, you know, just from National Agricultural Statistics Service of USDA, you know, they played a crucial role to educate statisticians in Georgia. For them, first, to understand the methodology, and then also the plan was that 2007 sample surveys of agricultural household has to be conducted by the sample survey. So it was a lot of work and intensive training session. And actually, Dr. Flavio mentioned in my introductory that we have organized more than 80 training sessions in Georgia only, you know, which means that we had a different level training session. First, we started training sessions to those who is like decision makers and who share responsibilities, who was really pushing toward the sample surveys. So, and actually we trained them in Georgia and in the United States, and then NAS always was a host of Georgian delegations to show, to explain them how they should be doing. It's according to the international standards and according to the principles of the sample surveys. So, and then first sample survey was conducted in 2007, and then sample size was 5,000. So another period of assistance, you know, just includes like 2007 and 2012. So, and actually this was the time that, okay, we had the data. So we conducted field work. Josat has conducted the field work, data was collecting. So, but it was another time to start analyze, to see what kind of data was collecting. And because of that, and what was problems and challenges of methodology, what was written for Georgia had in order to make some changes. So which means that it was a lot of work on data and to find the errors, to how to fix errors. So it was like a learning by doing, actually, with NAS experts and Geostat employees, like a specialist, we were working together, actually. We were opening data and then saying, okay, let's do, okay, teach us where we are learning. And that we are happy that, you know, I think many of you know that Michael Steiner was the first who came in Georgia in 2006. And actually, he was one of who really initiated the program. So we are very happy as a Georgian, you know, and that Georgia, that we got him to work and help Georgia to move gears towards the international standards of data collection. And then another activity was just we saw that it was needed to enrich technical advancements, you know, we saw that some technological advancements. So because it was a time that, you know, more software was used for data analysis and they need some equipment, computers. So this was that along with training, we tried to also provide some technological advancement, you know, like maybe some software, some guidelines, some, you know, for them to analyze and process data and to use it for data dissemination. And also now another side is, okay, finally we have data, but it was a lot of fight, I could say, the different government agencies, because it was new that even it was took several years to Geostat, like data producers, to understand. But of course you have another side and other ministries like agriculture and other data users that they remember everything from Soviet. So they're thinking about, oh, that data that my person in a village or in a district tells me, oh, this is correct data, and they don't know. So we several years, it was a fight between data producer and data user. So we said, wow, it's time, you know, just to make sure that those people sit together, along with experts not only from US government, but from EU, FAO, and we will talk together as a one team. We call like expert-level workshops, you know, because we wanted data user to present their interests, and also at the same time to have data producers to explain the methodology. Yeah, sometimes it was successful cases, sometimes it's not, because it was at times that when you do work and you educate people, you know, just in different, but it was a transition, changing in government, changing ministries, and then political decisions. It's always, somehow it's like sitting on a Ferris wheel. You know, when you go, you have to get out, you know, to go to somewhere else, but new people comes, and then you have to start again. So sometimes it's happened that sometimes we have to go from cycle. So, and then, yeah, actually I have, you know, bullet points that, yeah, executive, we had executed intensive personal trainings because we were finding, you know, who would be a person who was really believed in old system of data producing. So we worked with them to explain and how countries, the international community does the data producing. And then we had also technical exchanges, like study visits. And then it was in 2012, that first time, you know, just always we spent almost like 4 or 5 years to make sure that people in government, data users and producers understand what is this methodology says and what is the errors, what is the pros and cons of this system. But it was 2012 that Geostat decided that we have to move on computer-assisted web interviews, but for only for legal entities. Because it was another time, because people just have to enter data, you know, especially in rural areas, but they have not seen computer. And maybe today everyone has a computer, everyone has a smartphone. But even sometimes in the big cities, yes, but in the rural areas, who people always collecting data using some paper, they have to do some work using some laptop tablets, you know, with our assistance we bought and granted for only X statistics work. And when we started to explain them how to do it, we were afraid to push different buttons. And we said, guys, don't worry, push buttons and it will work. You know, if something happens, we have IT, we will fix. You know, just nothing will happen. But, you know, it was hard, but we said, okay, let's add another session of training. Because we sometimes when you plan something and you think that, oh, certain hours will be enough, during work you'll find out that you will need more time, you know. So more time, we said, okay, we were also good thing was with USDA, within Foreign Exchange Service and NAS, we always kept some flexibility ourselves, you know, to adjust real need, adjust to the enhancement of a system, not to put ourselves when you agree something and sign off, you know, it's very headache to change it. So we were trying to keep our activities flexible to adjust the real needs and not to be in a hurry. And then another phase, you know, just which is, I think, also in I personally, it's a really important time that this is a time that Geostat and then Minister of Agriculture, we have colleagues here from Georgia, both sides, and they really became a friends, finally. So, which means it's good. You know, we started talking, because in the past it was like USDA and then also just FAO, especially, but it was two international organizations provided some technical assistance, but we were sitting together, and then we saw cases that we were talking between them without us, so it was a really good case. But also, ministry just very really presented the need of data. You know, just said, okay, we want this data, and their data list was, oh my God. It was in an Excel sheet, it was several pages almost. I said, no, it was impossible, because if one side is that you have data produced, but who will analyze? Does another agency data users have a capacity to analyze? So, and actually, and we said, okay, you know, just, yeah, it's important to us, but let's make sure what is the number 20 priorities and address to this. And this cooperation has started. And then it was a time that UN has initiated that all countries has to develop a strategic plan for agriculture and rural statistics. So, and then Georgia was selected as one of a pilot country to work on that strategy. So, but in Georgia case, it was not only agriculture and rural statistics, but it was also added environmental statistics. So, yeah, so we added environmental statistics as well. So, and actually Georgia had a strategy for 2016 to 2020. And then also ministry wanted some operative data, we call it like objective, and we helped ministry to develop a surveys on objectives, yields, and it was like a four crops that, you know, just what we worked with ministry, and then ministry implemented the surveys. And then new surveys also was started by the Geostat on grain elevators and cold storages and slaughterhouses. So actually, and it was a time that sample sizes increased from 5,000 to 12,000, so which enabled Georgia to produce more regional indicators and national indicators. And then in 2014, Georgia has conducted the agricultural census along with the population census. We also, NAS experts played a crucial role to helping Georgia. And then also the data was released in 2016, but also when we wanted the data to be comparable with previous years, so we went there and reconciled the data on 2014 and 15. Actually, like pretty recently, also another initiative was, you know, just that Georgia became a pilot country for AGRIS, like agriculture integrated surveys. So FAO experts has helped Georgia to develop a labor module, and then it was implemented. And then most importantly, you know, which we also, Georgia implemented was a CAPI, computer-assisted personal interviews. So we said, okay, we don't want to get out of papers and we want to use all software. And it was that we, as USDA, we helped them to advance in, along with training to buy all this equipment, including like a tablets and then World Bank helps with the software. And also, we always try to collaborate with not only ourselves, but it was like several stakeholders, including the Georgian government. When we say that we help them bigger commitment was always from Georgian government. We were spending their resources. We were investing in new surveys, and we were in investing in their systems. And then also another survey, aquaculture survey, first time in Georgia's history that we started, and they're using GAPI to collect. And here's like a future plans, you know, future assistance areas. So we still want to continue work with Georgia, and we have some several areas, you know, that we are really looking to help, you know, maybe Georgia. It's like our wish list, you know, somehow, but we need to have consultations and the call. You know, we had a preliminary consultation with government, but we will continue with Georgian government and Geostat. So it will be a remote sensing and use of administrative data, and then to, you know, improve editing and analysis and efficiency and effectiveness, and then managing a sample frame, which is also very important because frame becomes older, and how to update and how to use this. Yeah, thank you. So just I thought this was my presentation.
Thank you for your nice presentation. We will open to the floor after all presentations. Interesting that he talked about a long-term collaboration, an intensive effort. We know that is very successful. George has a nice system nowadays. And stress also this governance dimensions on the capacity building. Super interesting. Well, now it's time for Naaman Keita. I have nothing written here because he's very noted person. Our colleague in the field during many years working on the census team and on the statistics division, and now acting as a consultant and collaborating in different projects. So you have the floor, Naaman. Thank you.
Thank you, Flavio, and good afternoon to everybody. So as Flavio said, my name is Naaman Keita. I am a retiree from FAO, so I'm just... this paper that I am going to present is in fact a paper that has been prepared by three people, as you can see the names here. Audrey Sano, who is a young statistician, and Major Fall, who is a senior statistician. I'm insisting on that because this is also a kind of particular type of technical assistance where we have a capacity building on two sides. One side is the country, the other side also to have some capacity with the young statisticians associated with the expertise to be delivered to the country. So I will briefly talk about an experience of AfriStat under the global strategy to deliver a master sampling frame in three countries. Now the experience I'm going to talk about here was done under the AfriStat, but the similar experience has been conducted in other countries under the African Development Bank. Here I will just focus on the case of Cabo Verde, Mali and Madagascar. So, as I said, the entry point for this technical assistance was master sampling frame. But you will see that through this master sampling frame, really the important element was capacity building. So, the master sampling frame, the global strategy has developed a handbook on the master sampling frame, laying out what is the master sampling frame, what are the steps to be taken to implement it. But now the issue was how to deliver this concretely in a given country situation. And many of the issues that has been indicated by my previous speaker are the same in most of these countries. So the two first slides will talk very briefly, and I can shorten that if the time is not enough, because this will talk about master sampling frame and the steps of development, and then go to the capacity building aspect, and then some of the lessons that can be learned from this experience. So these definitions you can find in the handbook developed by the Global Strategy. In any sense, the mass sampling frame is this. So in a usual situation, if you want to conduct a survey, for each one of the survey, you will have an ad hoc sampling frame. You need to build an ad hoc sampling frame. And this, especially if there are several institutions conducting surveys, the normal situation is that each institution will have to find its own sampling frame, develop it, and conduct its survey. Now, the idea of this master sampling frame is to try to have one sampling frame in which you can integrate different surveys. So they go together with having a master sampling frame and having an integrated survey framework, where you can see if there are compatibility with the sampling unit and the statistical unit. You can try to integrate the surveys using the same master sampling frame. And there are many, many advantages which are indicated in the document of the global strategy with doing this, including the reduction in the cost and the fact that the data can be related to each other for more in-depth analysis, etc. So there are many, many advantages with this. Now, there are a lot of benefits. Now, how to go about this and implementing this in a given country situation? The starting point is to see that the universe of the holdings can be categorized in two. One is the holdings in the household sector, and the other one is the holdings in the non-household sector. This is the definition coming from the World Census of Agriculture, of FAO. And in most of the developing countries, particularly African countries, you will see that the bulk of the holdings are in the holding sector. So this is where you have a lot of holdings. But I was interested in the presentation this morning of Hungary, where you can see that the statisticians need to be careful because they need to adapt their system to the evolution of agriculture. Now, the situation is that most of the holdings are in the household sector, but maybe in 20 years or 30 years, the situation may change. So we should not just develop a system, a static system. It has to be a system that can adapt to the evolution of the agriculture sector. Anyway, so the master sampling frame, in order to cover the universe in totality, should cover the households in the holdings in the household sector and the holdings in the non-household sector. In most African countries, the data for preparing a frame in the household sector is usually coming from the population census. And for the last 10, 20 years, many countries have made an effort to include an agriculture module into the population census, so that when you process that data, you can identify the agriculture holdings, and then this could serve as for developing the frame. In some countries, they conduct a complete enumeration agriculture census, which is a better solution even. And those two sources are the main sources for preparing the frame. So when that's the case, first of all, you need to have some kind of processing of this information in order to identify who are the agriculture households within the totality of the household. Typically, you will have, this is an extract for, this is a real case from a country where you will see that the household has an identifier, you have a number of variables for the household, including the age, the gender, but particularly if the household is engaged in agriculture, yes or no. So by processing this, you can identify which are the households which are engaged in agriculture, and this will be the starting point for developing your frame. Now, in the non-household sector, this is where we found out that in many African countries, there is a lot of effort to be done here because it is a kind of neglected area in the agriculture surveys in many countries. Now, maybe the impact is not very important because the contribution may be low, but this is a fast-growing sector. where the contribution in the future may be very, very important. So there is a need also to cover this sector in the agriculture surveys. And most of the time, there is a need to do a specific data collection on the sector in order to have a frame. Now, talking about the technical assistance, this is really the focus of this presentation. In the framework of the global strategy, AfriStat is an institution, a West African institution, has made a contract with FAO Global Strategy in order to develop this master sampling frame in a number of countries, including the three countries that I am talking about. So the capacity building activities were conducted through several expert missions in the countries. So practically, it consists in sending experts in the countries. And as I said, this expertise was composed of some senior experts and some junior experts. So a team of junior and senior experts going to the country and trying to provide the technical assistance. And there are mainly two forms of technical of capacity building. One was the formal training, so training the staff and providing the basic knowledge about what is the master sampling frame about. And but more importantly, on the job training, meaning that we build together the master sampling frame. So it's learning by doing on a daily basis, trying to do the thing. So when the experts come, we discuss what has to be done. We organize technical working groups. And then after the experts left, they continue to do the work. And then, of course, this way of doing things takes time. Because if you want to do it quickly, you just send experts, they do the job, and that's it. But if you really want to, as they say, if you want to go far, you need to do it together. If you want to go fast, you do it alone. So this is the most important thing is really the on the job training, which was important. Because one thing that we found in many of these countries is the weakness in the capacity on two sides. One is the manpower, the number of staff in the institutions doing the job is very limited. So that's the first thing. Second, as it was said also, with the rotation of the staff, people come and go. The people who had the capacity have moved to other institutions. So you need again to do some training. So these were really the most challenging aspect. And I remember the first time we met the Minister of Agriculture in Cape Verde. I told him, if you don't want to waste our time, we need a minimum number of staff in this institution to start anything. Because if we are one or two people, really it's a waste of time because you cannot do the job with this. And after 2-3 years, these people will leave again. So a big challenge is really, first of all, to have a minimum number of staff in this institution, and then the expertise not to substitute the nationals, but to work with them so that they learn by doing it. And this was an important aspect. In order to overcome a little bit the limitation of the manpower, the idea was to form technical working groups, multi-sectoral, so not only the National Statistical Institute, but also Minister of Agriculture and other ministries. So to have a team of these people working together. And all the institutional issues are there, because in many, as it was said also, many countries, you find that the National Institute of Statistics is not talking to the Minister of Agriculture. So you have to overcome those aspects first. And then once you do that, to have these working groups put together, and to ensure that there is availability of the staff, because they are also occupied doing the other things, etc. And this is one thing that most of the international institutions are not aware, because they keep on sending two or three missions to countries. The countries are overwhelmed because they don't have the capacity to absorb all these people coming and giving different type of messages. So this was the human aspect is very, very, very important. And then once you have this minimum number of staff in place, you can do the job, not in a hurry, but making sure that the people are absorbing the methodologies and you are evolving. So the technical assistance mainly included the assessment of the capacity of the countries, strengthening the technical and operational capacity is also important, because in addition to the lack of manpower, sometimes these services do not have the minimum infrastructure in place in order to conduct the survey. So there is a minimum level of infrastructure which is needed also. And then going through the technicalities of developing the master sampling frame, the process, the content, the structuration, and not only in theory, but trying to implement. The best advocacy is to show results. So to really go in the field and implement this master sampling frame, I still have 2-3 minutes, or is okay. So to implement this activity in the field and to show results. So, and that's what was conducted in these countries. And through the process, it was the entry point was the master sampling frame. But many aspects from data collection, using CAPI, the GPSs, the processing, the analysis, the staff had to go through all this process. So it's the best way of learning it. So they did it once. So hopefully they are able to reproduce it. And at the end, the results were presented by the staff itself, not by the expert. We make sure that the national staff are the ones who will present the results of this activity of this pilot surveys that has been conducted using this master sampling frame and the methodology and all the technical tools that were used in the operation. So basically, the master sampling frame consisted of, first of all, we found that there, as I said, many surveys independently conducted by different institutions. So the first thing was to have everybody in one room discuss all these surveys and to see how we can optimize a little bit these surveys and using one master sampling frame where it is possible in order to integrate the surveys. So through the discussion, we managed to find a kind of integrated survey framework. And then using the population census information. Sometimes the population census was very old, like in the case of Mali, for example. But it was more an exercise to showcase than to do it concretely, so that the next census which will be coming, they can reproduce the same thing. And then for the non-household sector, the idea would be, as I said, the data was lacking. So there was a need to conduct a specific operation to collect the information on this non-household sector. And then to build basically at the end, what we get is a database with two components, one component covering the household sector and the second component, second component covering the non-household sector. Okay, I will just, the same, but in the case of Cape Verde, it was interesting because first of all, they had been conducting surveys the last 20 years. And then from the 2010-11, everything stopped and all the staff went away. So they were not conducting any survey anymore. So we had to restart everything. But they had conducted an agriculture census in 2015, a complete enumeration agriculture census using high-level technology, georeferencing all the households and the holdings, and even georeferencing some of the irrigated parcels. So there was a very rich database. The problem is the database was in the Institute of Statistics, and the Minister of Agriculture did not have access to that database. So the first fight was how to make sure that the Minister of Agriculture can access this database in order to build the sampling frame. But it went very well in Cape Verde, and we managed to get the database. There was a need to integrate the surveys also. And then finally, let me show. So just to show that I'm sure this is too small, but The survey, pilot survey was conducted, and really we were surprised that it went very well. And you can see the estimation of area from the pilot survey and from the agriculture census. It's about 60,000. I think that's from the agriculture census. And the second is 63,000. So it went very well. But, just to finish the last slide, I want to, yeah. So one of the findings of the experience of the technical assistance of AfriStat in the countries was the key role of capacity building in the early stages of the technical assistance for the master sampling frame. Given the limitation in resources, defining priority surveys and their potential for harmonization and integration is a good practice. And another challenge is often the lack of recent data that can be used for building the master sampling frame. But in this exercise, even if the data was old, we used it as a demonstration for the demonstration purpose in view of the future more recent data. And it means that the results that we showed mean that it is feasible. Despite all the challenges that I mentioned, it means that if you put everybody together and all the things together, it is possible to deliver this technical assistance and to start building the capacity in the country. So institutional issues, multi-sectoral working groups, and to overcome a little bit the manpower issue. And if you manage to cover all this aspect, I think people can learn the survey methodologies, they can learn the technical tools, and we were lucky we had some young people and they pick up very quickly all these technical things and even faster than us. But the final point is really to have a lasting impact. The technical assistance has to be over a certain duration. It's not a quick fix. You cannot just go and do it and that's all. I think it has to take some time so that people have the time to absorb and to be able to implement it. Thank you very much.
Well, let me also stress the importance of learning by doing, like the colleague, and to go to the country with a top that will be implemented. Né? And I think it's very important the stability of the staff. Otherwise, the effort cannot be relevant for the country. Well, now we move to a colleague, Godfrey Saga. Godfrey is an agricultural statistician working with the Eastern African Statistical Training Center in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. He's currently teaching agricultural statistics in the center and other agricultural-related statistics from their collection, analysis, compilation, and reporting. Prior, it joined the ESTAC. He has participated in working the research assistant with the Sokonai University of Agriculture in Morogoro, Tanzania, to collect and analyze from various agricultural households. Recently, Godfrey has received a capacity building entering in the World Bank through the Center of Development Data in Rome and in FAO to develop core agricultural questionnaire and to relate instruments in the 5x30 initiative and sampling strategy. Godfrey has participated in many e-learning courses organized by FAO to build capacity and open data management in agriculture. He has also, from time to time, participated in Tanzania National Bureau of Statistics activities related to agricultural statistics to blend theory and practical aspects of agricultural statistics. He is a prospective doctor in philosophy in geospatial science, candidate on RD University. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair. My colleague of the International Conference on Agriculture Statistics, as I've been introduced, I'm here to share experience on what ISTEC is doing. ISTEC is it's a strong institution. It has a good history since 1965. It was owned by the United Nations, the UNDP, and the former EAC to train the lower cadres before the EAC collapsed in 1977. Now the center is under Tanzania Minister of Finance and Planning. It was commissioned by UNECA. And the primary objective of establishment of ISTEC was to improve capability of the user countries to produce and use statistical data that is needed for evidence-based decision-making by training personnel involved in the production and the usage of statistics, official statistics within the statistical framework. And that was one of the center's strategic goal. The centers run several short courses and long courses in statistics through certificate to master's level, including agriculture statistics. The agriculture statistics is offered to master's degree, although they are also short courses. We have academic collaborations with several institutions, academic institutions, and most of them are from India. We have MOUs with them, but others as consultancies in either capacity building or training or research. And those, as you can read, we have them MOUs with the Indian Statistical Institute. We also have MOU with the National Statistical System Training Academy. We also have MOU with the Sokoine University of Agriculture. We also have MOU with the Open University of Tanzania. And currently we have 19 member countries that are served by ISTEC. Since 1994, there was a protocol that was signed by the Tanzania and the user countries to support capacity building in areas of official statistics. Now, the achievement from the countries I've mentioned, you have seen them through the maps, their flags. Most of East African countries, they've been benefited over 80% since the establishment of the center. But countries that are coming from the southern part of Africa, they've benefited by 17%. And those from West, only 2% since the establishment of the center. And this because most of the Western African countries in the protocol are not there. Another achievement is we have the IT department, which develops some statistical information systems that facilitate some activities in agricultural sector. The first one is Electronic Population Register System. It's the EPRS. It collects some administrative or routine data system. It have different modules, and this one has been tested to some regions of Tanzania. We are thinking to scale up in the future to user countries, whether it can facilitate. It have some modules on agriculture statistics, the household statistics, education statistics, some vital transition, revenue statistics, health statistics. And it is mobile. Also, it is accessible through the web application. Below there, I have a link. Unfortunately, I don't have the internet connection. I could have shown you inside it. So this is EPRS. It can further be linked to use the to household certification when you want to do some sampling. So you can easily get this one, because with this system, this is the dashboard of the household statistics where you can do sampling. It gives updates of the anything that, whether somebody, there is a newborn or whatever, you get updates, or there is a migration within, or you get new updates of the households in a certain localization. So this one is used by district executive officers for planning. Okay, if you want to send a service there, you get updates within the 7 days that there is a change in a certain module. So this is also, we are still testing it in the country, and it works. Another one is the Tanzania Cooperative Development Commission Management System. This one has been designed to manage statistics on registration of cooperatives, processing of agricultural inputs, collection of crops, transportation of crops, sales, subsidies, but the objective of this one is to achieve timely and efficient allocation of agricultural resources. This one is also still under development. Now let me now say a bit on training agricultural statistics as part of capacity building and transformation of the agricultural sector. Before I say this, for instance, in Tanzania, more than about 70% of the households, they depend their livelihood in the agricultural sector. So any transformation that is done in the sector, it will have crucial impact to their livelihood. So the training is short run. Also, we have the long-term training. The short-term training is most cases hands-on trainings, but the long-term training, it has the theory and the practice. Why we do have the theory? Because sometimes they come people who are not working within the national social system, so they have to get the background of agricultural statistics before they do the practical part of it. The teacher's qualification, apart from academic qualification, we depend on people or lecturers who have worked within the statistical framework, who have participated in activities related to that. So like this forum, you are the good people to be teachers of ESTEC. Now the short run, we have the training of trainers, we have the tailor-made trainings, also we have training of individuals. And in this case, we use the modules that were suggested by FAO on the basic training course in agricultural statistics. So we have four modules that are involved. The first one is an overview for general framework of agricultural statistics. The second one is data sources, statistical units, and the collection methods. Data processing, analysis, and dissemination. Also, we have analytical framework and the derived statistics. To mention few, what do I mean by those? The model one, people, they need to know what is the scope, the concept, and the classification. Also, they need to know the conceptual framework of the global strategy. Who are the main users and the uses of statistics? Data sources, we have to also to explain the main sources, or what are statistical units, also the data collection methods, the modern one and the old ones. And the modern ones, the modern ones, before the short course ends, normally these people, they do a short survey through either CAPI or web, it depends on the circumstances. Also, the data processing, analysis, and the steps, so people, they have to understand. Also, the frameworks, or there are also cross-cutting issues that they have to know as a agricultural statistician. The economic accounting, the agricultural cost of production, agricultural prices, post-harvest losses, also the structure of the food balance sheet. Now, we have some supporting initiatives from the Global Strategy Fund, And the World Bank, through training for a cultural statistician, in short course. And in the very recent, about 61 are participants of the National Statistical Offices. They've benefited with the training, short course training in a basic course in agricultural statistics. Now, the long-term training, there are so many modules, but here I've just picked a few. The first one is the agricultural statistical forecasting. We also have the GIS and the remote sensing, design of agricultural experiments, sampling techniques, ICT and the statistical computing agriculture. We have also small area estimation. Also, these people, they have to know the statistical quality control, because collecting data without having the quality data in it is a problem. Also, we have the food security modules. These modules were developed in collaboration with the Sokoine University of Agriculture in Tanzania, also with some consultants from IASRI here in India. And since establishment of the master's degree, and these graduates are now working with the statistical system, we have 10 males and one woman have graduated with the master's degree. So we still have to pull more women to engage in the sector. Now the forecasting techniques, students are taught how to use the weather parameters, crop parameters, or plant characteristics, and how they can model. Also, the very recent, the process-based model, which use the system approach of land use sustainability. This model has been planned to be used in Tanzania to forecast yield, so it's also taught there. So it's a good timing as well for the country. The GIS and the remote sensing, students, they are taught on how they can access data and the software solutions. Some of the software that are used, like QGIS, ArcGIS, and the others, how they can do the crop area mapping and the land cover, also designing sampling frames. The very recent ISTEC have received capacity from the World Bank through the Center for Development Data on how to do sampling frame using remote sensing. Also, we have the crop area and the crop estimation using remote sensing. Early warning system for food security. Students are also taught on how to do drought analysis and some vegetation indices to analyze them as an early warning system. Also, we have the modules on design of experiments. People, they have to know the cause and effect. So many different designs are taught that are in the agriculture sector. Also, we have the sampling survey techniques. The probability and the non-probability methods are used. So these modules prepare the samplers in agricultural statistics. Also, many statistical softwares are applied, like to mention is R programming is also used. Now the ICT, this one is the modern one for cost effective. It ensures timeliness and efficiency in the production of data, in the data production cycle. So in this one, we use the CAPI, computer-assisted personal interview, and as a center, from time to time, has received capacity from the World Bank. And this one has been used in some of the surveys in Tanzania. Small area estimation, this one is the current thing. For instance, in Tanzania, I don't have experience from other countries. Most of the data that are used in decision making, they are available at national level and the regional level. For instance, in Tanzania, we have the three levels of decisions. We have the national level, we have the region level, and we have the district level. It's the lower level. Now, the data at the lower level, which is mostly used in decision making at the lower level, is not available. It's not collected. So by introducing the smaller area estimation, we ensure that the data at lower level, special district level, will be obtained for decision making. It's very, very important. So there are different models that are used under that one, like the Fahrenheit models, which they link the survey data and the auxiliary, available auxiliary information. The statistical control, this is also very important. When you talk about the statistical control, it's very important. You can have the quality attribute, but you have to do statistically. Like how do you analyze the margin of error and the others. So normally we use the different quality frameworks. For example, the quality assurance framework of the European statistical system is also useful when we do the training. I think this slide is misplaced, but it is linked to small area estimation. Okay. It is linked to the small area estimation. For instance, in Tanzania, 2016-17, there are 30 regions, and out of them, 25 from Tanzania mainland and 5 from region. But the data is not available for the district level. So this one, it emphasizes the importance of having the smaller estimation modeling. Another one is the food security. This is also important. Students are taught on how to compute indicators of food security through the FAO standards. Also, students, they are taught practically on how to do exercise on preparing the food balance sheet of the country. We're using other countries' experiences. ISTEC, we've participated in many activities related to agriculture statistics, as you can see them, from the country level to the international level. The main problem we are facing is the GIS lab for remote sensing practicals. And another one is lack of harmonized curriculum for French and English speaking countries, because official statistics in Africa, there are only two institutions. For English speaking countries, ISTEC, and for French speaking countries, ENSEA, in Côte d'Ivoire. So we don't have the harmonized curriculum across African countries for international comparison. Let me end by the way forward and conclusion. If FAO and other international organizations can facilitate establishment of the GIS lab, also the harmonization process of the agricultural statistics curriculum within the training institutions, it will have impact on transformation of agriculture. But for ISTEC, the international organization, also we invite you to invite trainers at the center for short courses training, because knowledge is not limited. The internship programs, also for long-term training, if some chances to have PhDs in the agricultural statistics as well, it will be important. But the last one is the e-learning programs, okay? For instance, FAO, USDA, if you can develop some programs in e-learning to build capacity to staff, it will be nice. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Geoffrey. We just hear about a specialized institution on training, a comprehensive set of trainings, no? And now we move to Norvandi, is a colleague from the National Institute of Statistics on Cambodia, is linked to the Minister of Planning. So we are moving to the institution to receive some capacity building from other institutions. Norvandi has an MBA and is 16 years in the branch of national accounts in the NIS, and recently moved to the Economic Statistics Department. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks, Excellency, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to present about the way to improve agriculture statistics in Cambodia. The question is, do you need to improve the agriculture statistics? Do you need to improve? I don't need, but I want to improve. Why? I like it. Why I like it? Because I need quality. Yes, about the statistic. So why we improve? Because we find any way to improve. What Cambodia find a way is we try to have any conduct the licenses, follow up the survey. Why we do the conduct the surveys and the census? Because depend on the law, the statistical law. We have the Cambodia, we have the statistical law, with the clearly defined that adopted for the National Institute of Statistics Cambodia have two, the conduct the census and the survey, and any other ad hoc observation. Yeah. So on that point, we have agriculture census 2013 is the first census, and population census recently we conducted, we already done the field enumeration. So, and now we move to improve in the agriculture statistic. So we collaboration at the project FAO capacity building to have the Cambodia Intercentral Agriculture Survey. This the topics that we the title of the survey that we already done in the 2019. Yeah. Now we are on the field data cleaning and analysis. And so we have to do the cooperation with other line ministry, like the Ministry of Agriculture and the local technical assistant FAO, the country, the Cambodia, and other relevant like local NGOs for the consultation. For let's me I think you know census, yeah. So these are our census we have. Before we used the paper questionnaire, and now we try to move on to copy you from the previous the presentation. You know the copy, yeah, that very good tool for the update the system of the data collection. And our census 2013 agriculture census we already published in 2015 and by the FAO technical assistant. So. And now the population census is the very useful for the frame using in the agri survey and intercensual agriculture survey that we already field enumeration done in July and August this year. So This is a very new frame that we have from the population census, the last one. So, and this population census, we plan to release the second quarter of 2020. Yes. This is how we developed the CIAS, this means Cambodia Intercensal Agriculture Survey. That is the by law we have defined after the census, 5 years we have to conduct the Cambodian Intercensal Agriculture Survey. That is the cooperation and the project FAO, technical assistance and the budget and collaboration with the government budget. So we have successfully field enumeration using the latest technology, the copy, like tablet, use tablet. So it's a fun as you mean that I very happy that I met the founder. Founder is Bill Gates. That's the first day we have met him. That our dream to meet him is the richest world for to provide this fund. And how we to get quality of the survey? So this is our process. First, we need to have to collect all the information from the data user. So we conduct the data user workshop. And to input many information we collect from the various user to in the questionnaire design. So, and then we have sampling method. How much we need to conduct and question how much we collect from the household and what kind of the sampling we selected, sample selected. And that now we use a copy, as you know, for the copy. If talking about the copy, you know, it looks an easy way, but not easy, since we need to clear the process, like how to recruit, how define in the condition of the enumerator or supervisor, and clearly define the role. This difficulty, but difficult can be solved if we try to step by step. And then we have the data cleaning and analysis method and imputation. This we use the method software that all software that we linking to the copy system that we use automatically cleaning imputation. Yes, this as I mentioned about the I should skip about the process that we are conduct the workshop for collecting input for the questionnaire design. In the questionnaire design, we have the two main part is a paper base, and in the copy questionnaire base. Since we, when we have paper base, we first we need to testing first. After the testing, we upload to the copy, and then after the define in the tablet, so we need to field test again for how to it's work. Yeah. And for the sampling method, I think from the previous presentation, very clear about how to select, how to use. I think this I'm not talked much about this, but we use two-stage sampling methodology. Two-stage. First, we need to define the enumeration area. Second, is select household agriculture. As from previous presentation, also show the classic. Two main parts is household agriculture and non-household agriculture. Also, we process something do like that. So thank you for the previous presentation. Yeah. And copy, yes, this again, I think this how we to show you how we process in copying. Copy. We since we have conduct the whole country that we have 25 province in the country. So we have the headquarter and then we have the subnational. So in each subnational, we have the department of planning. We call a provincial Department of Planning. So in each provincial department planning, we recruit enumerator and supervisors for to join the survey. And then we have training them in the central headquarters and then the local provincial. And then we control from the headquarters to monitoring of how they are processed in each enumeration area. And the field test, as I mentioned, that we in questionnaire design in paper, we first test. And then we after we upload copy tablet, so we have to test again, yeah, to make sure that the the software is progress smoothly, yeah. And for the data cleaning and analysis, this is very important. But we need to have more technical assistance to do this. I think since we are changing fast from the paper base to the technology like copy, so and then you know copy using the linking like software analysis or studio radio, so we have to improve and more capacity building training on hand for more national static office like NIS Cambodia. We still need this to do for more sustainable resource. And you know, we not only have this survey, we have the other survey, so we need to use that people. Okay. And then, but we hopefully finish this data analysis cleaning by November. And then we will some preliminary analysis in December, and hopefully we complete result in release in January 2020 for the CIAS Cambodia 2019. And this imputation, this is also very important. We, you know, the survey, we have some data missing or non-responding, but we try to fix them. How to fix them is the imputation. What we imputation is a plan area and plan tree that we focus on the crop sector. And we using the all Studio is one software that we can use automatically treat on the data imputation. And yeah, we hopefully complete in December this year, and the publication will be released next year in January. And I mentioned this again for the capacity building. This very important that we, since we cooperate with NAS, Statistics Office, and the Ministry of Agriculture and Fishery, we call MAF. So this we need to strong cooperation to do these surveys, and NAS have leading in the methodology of the survey, like the data collection. But who are using the data is the Ministry of Agriculture, is the main user or main distributor of data, so they can use data that we produce, and then they can develop any policy regarding to the agriculture policy. Yeah, this skill when I already talked, I think we need to define the responsibility role or something that in the each institutional arrangement, like MAF and S. Yeah. So this we create one group for collaboration. We easy to contact to each other for that. Yes, thank you. But that's all my presentation. Yes, thank you.
The case of Cambodia, I was involved because is an activity of the survey team in FAO. We try to support in techno assistance, but in terms of creating really capacity in the country to be overcome in terms of technical all the steps, was hard in their case because they have a very strict time schedule to achieve the goals in terms of production data. But many activities on training was done, and we're going to do more in the future. Okay, we have time for some questions and discussions. The floor is open. Please introduce yourself and.
My name is Diana Martin. I'm from Uruguay, and I have a question for Namang. Could you please tell me how long it took to you the whole process for making the sample, the master sample design for those countries, including the quality control?
Do you have any more questions, or I
reply immediately? No, okay, let's see if we have more questions. Abirash.
Okay, the first question is just for maybe Naman in Georgia. We always conduct training capacity building, but the issue is how to make it sustainable. And some projects, they provide training. Then after, it's very difficult for countries to take it over. So what is your advice for making more sustainable capacity building for countries, and how can countries take it over after the project is finalized? That's one issue. The other one for maybe Cambodia, you used paper-based census, and I'm surprised because even most developing countries are using tablets, so why don't you use tablets?
The issue of staff migrating from institutions is something that is not new. They will keep on moving. In fact, when you train them, they get the reason even to go away. The issue sometimes can be structural, and it's about the way institutions are structured. Some you can find they have economic surveys, others are structural, no, are social. So you find when a staff is deployed, sometimes they are rotated out of a certain area, say from socioeconomic surveys to economic surveys. Now, if you've taught that person to handle master sampling frames, you'll find their new role, especially if it's household level, where they go, they will not be in a position to undertake that. You also lose that kind of expertise. So it's just about the overall administration sometimes. So people migrate out of the institution, but even within institutions, some staff are rotated, and the capacity will be there, but you'll not be able to tap it. That is my fear.
Last question was from Patrick von Urbus. Can you introduce yourself?
Laverne.
I'm Patrick Okello, Uganda Bureau of Statistics.
Okay, my name is Laverne Mapp. I'm a planning officer in the Ministry of Agriculture in Grenada, staff of one, responsible for statistics, which includes censuses and surveys. My question is for our first presenter. You said you're moving away from paper-based to online. The online, is it copy or is it web-based where the farmers would upload the information? Because for us, it's already difficult for our enumerators to go out and interview farmers, much less for them to upload information. We know that wouldn't work for us. So what is your suggestion?
I think we have no time for more questions. So, you have a question. So the last question from Naman, and then we go to the...
My question is to the friend from Tanzania.
Godfrey,
yeah. This electronic system that you developed, I remember that the JICA had put computers in the district in Tanzania, etc. Now, first of all, is the system really working, and who is doing the job at the field level? Who is updating? Because the thing that you showed so should be updated regularly, but who is doing the updating, and is there a methodological document developed to back this? So I should not ask questions better.
Okay, we can follow the sequence of presentations. So first, okay.
Thank you for the question. So I will start with the first question, and I will repeat it. How to make capacity of staff sustainable after the project ends? Yeah, actually, it's always risky, you know, because you generally work with different country, different government, different people, and then of course you have to think much ahead of time, you know, what will happen after you exit. So which means that first of all, you have to carefully listen and to understand what is a priority of the country, you know, what local, like in George case of Georgia, what National Statistics Office, what is their strategy, what resources the government or institutions are committed to invest. Because it's not that when we have a project, when we support it, you know, it's not that we were agreeing, telling them that, okay, here's an idea and we will do everything for you. We never have done for them or work for them. Where we are doing, you know, it's not like a give a fish, but to teach how to fishing. So, and also we realize that the work, especially when we are changing a methodology and moving to the new system, you need to have it also from your side, long-term, more or less long-term commitment. And you will see, you saw in the presentation that, you know, Georgia, it was Georgia moved on a sample surveys in 2007. And then today, they moved on the copy. And they all transitioned on different ways. So it was not that we were telling them. It was that, oh, we learned about this new initiative. Or sometimes we were telling, okay, here's the initiative. Can you do it? If you like, you have to invest from your side. Or it was a cases that, for example, different division were established, you know, on like agriculture statistics divisions, or the staff of Geostat, especially agriculture statistics department, was doubled when the sample size increased. And then when staff doubled, it was not that we were paying salaries for them, you know. No, we did not. We never paid any salaries, and we never paid any dollar for data collection, which was where we spend our resources to educate them, to teach them how to do. So which means that if your sample size has increased from 5,000 to 12,000, so what was the extra cost, like additional interviews, additional papers, additional equipment? It was done by the Georgian government. So which means that, first of all, government has to be committed, and then you have to have this dialogue with them that when the project ends, how we will continue. And then another thing is that you have to train also multiple people, not only one or two people, because it's always the case that people will leave or we will move another better position. So, and actually regarding the second question, you know, just, yeah, actually computer-assisted web interviews or per copy. Yeah, Georgia, you know, in the chronology I moved, it was in 2012 that Georgia started data collection using a web-based interviews, but nowadays they moved on copy, you know, and they are doing copy and not.
Yeah, first question about the duration. As I said, I think, you know, I have more than 20 years working in FAO doing this capacity building and technical assistance, etc. Really, really, if you want to do a serious job, you cannot use a quick fix. You cannot do that very in a short time and just do some have something sustainable. Now, this was a very small project, what we did, with really few thousands of dollars. And basically, the assistance, the duration is more or less 1 year. 1 year, yeah. But for me, it is not finished. Even normally, I keep on talking to Flavio, to Vincent, to say that there are still some work to be done in order to really to have this result somehow sustainable. I'm not sure it will be sustainable, but I think you need some time to really fix this technical assistance issue. And this leads to the very tough question of sustainability. I really believe the international community has a long experience, but many times failures about this technical assistance in the countries. I think the Paris 21 has developed a new concept of technical assistance and capacity building. And there is nothing new under the sky. Eh? But one of the key things that they stress is that you should focus on institutional strengthening instead of individual capacity. So not just train individuals, but try to strengthen the whole system. It's tough, it's difficult, but probably that's one way out of this issue, dilemma of technical assistance and capacity building. So basically, of course, you need to continue some all these formal trainings and individual training, but it's not enough. You need to do more than that and to strengthen the capacity so that if one individual leaves, the whole system is not collapsing. And that's really the big challenge. And perhaps the starting point is what our colleague from Georgia, USDA, said. The key is the motivation of the country. I think if you, sometimes the institutions go and international institutions, they try to help countries, but the country has to take ownership of the system, and the best situation is if the request is coming from the countries. That's the reply. Okay. In this specific case, African Development Bank first did a kind of survey of countries on the methodologies that has been developed by the global strategy. And it was the countries themselves who said, okay, I am interested in developing the master sampling frame. That's my interest. That was not enough. So there was a need for an official request from the country saying that really they are serious about it, they want to do it, and then followed by assessment missions, going to the countries and having high-level discussions with, for example, we sat with the Minister of Agriculture, and after doing the assessment to say, okay, we have been doing technical assistance in Cape Verde here for, I don't know, the last 10, 20 years. Now, if we really
don't want to continue technical assistance, how can we go about it? And what are the minimum conditions, including the fact that when the, this is just a project, when the project is finished, how to continue the thing. So there are some of these steps, and as I said, one of the new aspects is institutional strengthening, not only individual capacity building, but focusing on the institution. And as I said, if this is achieved, maybe you can minimize somehow the issue raised by Patrick, which is that staff, one staff trend is moving, but as long as he is moving inside the institutions and the institutions are working together, it's not a loss. But this aspect has not been stressed in the past, but now I think more and more people are taking conscious of this. And there is a very well developed paper by Paris 21. It's called Capacity Development 4.0. You can go on the web and look at it. And some of these new ideas about capacity building and technical assistance are there. I hope I've not forgotten anything.
Okay, thank you. Let's respond quickly on the Naaman question. This EPRS is both. It's mobile-based and web-based. So there is an app. And the app is accessed through the Android system. So if you have the mobile phone, and in Tanzania, most of the people, they have the phones. And the data can be uploaded offline if you don't have the internet. But when you have access to internet, then you synchronize. And nowadays in Tanzania, because there is a spread of the networks, even the, in the villages, data is not a big problem. But you have access now. At the lowest level is the village executive officers. And these people, before they start doing anything, they get training. They get training because they're under local government authorities. So they get training on how to use this application. Both mobile-based and web-based, where if there is computers. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a response to the about why Cambodia not use the tablet for the census data collection. Since they, some most countries they conduct using the tablet or copy, right? This we thinking about the technology. First, we have to have the tool, the machine, tablet. If you use a tablet, you need more money, much money. Yeah, this is the first. But what more than this, this is how to manage this copy. Since the people they can use this, then we use like the population census, is the big work. Many number of, lot of the number enumerator using local and central. So how we manage this? And then especially we also considering if we not use the tablet, we use the smartphone. The smartphone is the maybe it's less cost of the for like the tablet more, much more cost, but the important thing is the coverage like the internet satellites can capture all the area or not. That's why we not yet to move on the like the big tasks. So we try to from the small one, the survey first. my director general also thinking about the next population. It's maybe move on to the using smartphone like Vietnam, and they can have already done about using smartphone. Smartphone they use the like the copy and the web in app in the phone, so they can synchronize or any time they, this that we have to learn that. So and we have to train them how to train from central to the local. This is a very difficult task and very need to careful to achieve them. Yeah. So, but I interesting that they used from the paper-based to the using the online or web data collection. My question is concern is about how the people that they cannot access the online, the web, they feel in the questionnaire. This. Like the Cambodia, I think like Cambodia from some people they cannot read and write, so how they fill that form and send the answer to the central or from send back the answer to the questionnaire. It's interesting that the question to the, you, I think maybe okay. Some.
Okay, thank you. Later we can discuss in particularly. I want to thank the audience that stay here 10 minutes more than the time and the question that enrich the discussion and the understanding and our speakers. So thank you very much.
Hello. At the end of the session, I would like to thank Mr. Bolliger for conducting this session. Thank you so much, sir. And I have one announcement for poster presentation. Those having poster presentation, they can put their poster from 8 a.m. tomorrow in hall number 2 and 3 on third floor. And boards and material are provided there. And please print your abstract ID and poster ID on the poster and put a sleeve with your abstract ID and poster ID on your boards. Thank you so much.